What is going on, people of the internet? My name's Connor Moriarty. Welcome to another video, and today we're talking about photo gear. That's right, there's like a million different things out there that you can buy as a photographer, but today we're gonna tackle some of them and tell you what you should prioritize and buy first, and maybe what you should hold off on and buy a little later once you're making some more money. So without any further ado, let's go right into it. Alright guys, so a really good friend of mine asked me just a couple days ago, Connor, what gear do I buy? You know, there's just so much gear out there. So, I mean, it's a really good question. What do you buy first? What do you start with? What do you work your way up to? And what's like the end all goal that you're trying to get to? So, if you're like me, most photographers, we're broke. That's how we start. We have no money. We're faced with like these $5,000 cameras, $2,000 lenses. So it's like, what do we do? You can be like some people I know and be like, screw the lenses, screw the camera. I'm getting a $2,000 drone. Wrong answer. But really, I'm like 6 years into my photography career now, and I wish that when I was getting started, there was somebody that just said to me, Connor, this is what you buy first. This is what you wait to get. So that's what I'm here to do. So I started off like any other photographer. I picked up a crappy DSLR, my mom's actually, when I was really young. Just started playing with it. I learned a thing or two. I saved up some money, bought my own, a little higher end DSLR. Started making some more money, And eventually I'm to where I am now, where I have like the top of the line L-series Canon gear. I have the top Canon bodies. I have some great strobes. I have tripods. I have modifiers. I have computers, hard drives, everything. So, but as someone who's just starting, it can look really intimidating for like, all right, I see you have all that stuff, but how do I get to that point? What's the order I go in? Oh, and by the way, I do want to give you guys some disclaimers. So obviously, this is my opinion. This is the order I went in to be the type of photographer I wanted to be. It can vary for anyone else if they want to be in a different field of photography or if they just grew up a different way. Also, I'm particular to Canon. That's just what floats my boat. I'm not a Nikon guy. There are two different ways of doing the same thing. They're both great stuff. Even Sony's doing some awesome stuff. So I'm just gonna give my two cents about Canon gear primarily. But yeah, I just wanna let you guys know right off the bat. Also, I just wanted to give one more disclaimer. While making this video, I'm assuming that you, the viewer, know a thing or two about photography, that you're just starting out, but you want that ultimate goal to become a professional photographer. This video isn't going to be so much for the hobbyists, the people that just want a camera to use for day-to-day life. So I'm just going to be assuming that you've already started taking photos, you know you love photography, you know you want to be a professional, but you might just not have the right camera yet or the gear and you're just starting off. And also, right before I get started, go ahead and feel free to give me some support. Hit that subscribe button below. That would be really awesome. I'm looking forward to making some other great content just like this. Also, go ahead and leave a comment down below. Tell me what gear you can't live without. I know I have my particulars. I'll let you know what they are later, but let me know what you can't live without. I'd like to hear it. So that's enough rambling. Without any further ado, let's get right into it. So first up, essentials. You're just starting out as a photographer. You realize you want to be a professional one day, but you just don't know where to start. So first and foremost, the number one most important thing you're gonna need as a photographer, obviously, a camera. More specifically, a full frame DSLR. So you already know what a DSLR is. You've been using one for a while now, probably, if you're watching this video, but you're gonna wanna eventually invest in a full frame DSLR. Basically, what full frame DSLRs are, they're 1:1 aspect ratios. They're exact copies of 35 millimeter film that were used back in the day, and they're as true to the image that you're photographing as could possibly be. There are a lot of different options out there for full frame Canon cameras. This applies to other companies as well, guys, so it's not just Canon. What I shoot with, what this is, it's a Canon 5D Mark III. this is my baby, this is amazing, this is what most professionals use. There's a 5D Mark IV out right now, 5DSR, all these different variations of the 5D, but this is the one everyone goes for. This will run you over $2,000, pretty expensive, but it's something you should definitely work up to. There are less expensive options out there for you. The Canon 6D is also full frame, that's an amazing camera as well. And if you want to bump up your price range and spend like $6,000 on a camera, the Canon 1DX, that's just the tank of all Canon cameras. You know, that thing is unstoppable. But for our purposes, this is what most people use. This is a fantastic camera. This is what you should save up for. But I'll show you something else. This is probably something that you're used to seeing. This is my camera that I started off with. It's the first camera I myself ever bought. It's a Canon EOS Rebel T3i. This is not nearly as expensive as full frame cameras. It is not full frame, but it's still an amazing DSLR. This is what I learned photography on. It has great manual settings, a flip out screen that you can record video on, tons of different options. This is what showed me my love for photography, and I am forever in debt to this camera. But I eventually bought this one, and there is nothing like it, so this is the one you eventually need to save up for. All right, the next thing you're gonna need is a wide angle zoom lens. So this is the one I started off with the same time I started off with that T3i. This is an 18 to 55 lens. I don't even know what the aperture is. I want to say 4.5 to 5.6. So it's a kit lens, really cheap, comes with the camera. It gets the job done, but it's in no way a professional lens. But this is the type of thing you're going to need to buy right off the bat. You can do so many things with this. It's super versatile. It lets you get really wide at 18 millimeters, but then lets you zoom in to 55, which is a pretty decent zoom in strength. So this is a great little lens, cheap option, gets the job done, but eventually you'll need to upgrade to something a little better, like what I'm using to film this video right now, which is a 24-70 2.8 lens. Now Canon makes the most amazing 24-70 2.8 lens there is. Everyone has it, everyone who's anyone, but that thing is so expensive, over $2,000, crazy expensive. What I like to use, which is what I'm actually using to film this video right now, is a Tamron 24-70. It's pretty much the same. The only thing is, it's super cheap. It's so much cheaper than Canon. You're not paying for the Canon name. You know, sorry Canon, I hate to say it, but it's true. This lens is amazing. I love it. It has image stabilization, and I paid like $1,000 less for it. So I love this guy. But yeah, if you have a wide angle zoom lens, you can do anything. You are so versatile. You can take photos of so many different things and you will be set. All right, so after you got that wide angle lens, the next thing you need is a telephoto lens. Basically, all that means is a lens that can zoom in a lot further. So this is the lens that I used along with the lens I just showed you right when I started photography. This is a 55 to 250. So it starts at the range that the lens I just showed you ends at, and it goes all the way up to 250. So it gives you a lot of reach. It's a great lens. This is super cheap as well. Doesn't run you for that much money at all. Anyone can afford it. And it gives you some really nice photos, beautiful portraits, beautiful wildlife shots. It allows you to zoom in so much more. Then, once you're done with this guy and you want to upgrade a little more, you can go to something like this. Oh, it's actually a barbell. It's not actually a lens. Seriously, this thing is so heavy, but this is a Canon 70-200 2.8 lens. Again, this is what is like the industry standard for a telephoto lens. Also, this thing is like my baby. If you guys can't hear it right now, the angels are singing above me. Like, this lens is absolutely amazing. Just like the high-end Canon L-series glass that I just talked about, this thing's gonna run you over $2,000, or just up to $2,000, I think. Really expensive, but so worth it, guys. This lens is absolutely amazing. When I first touched it, I used it for wildlife. You could zoom in right up on birds and deer or anything you might want to photograph. But what I soon learned is that this thing is absolutely beautiful with portraits. You zoom in with somebody on this shooting 2.8, you'll get the most amazing shots you'll ever have in your entire life. So, this guys, if you ignore everything else in the video, this is what you want to work up to. This is the prize. This is the light at the end of the tunnel. This is it. All right, guys, so I was considering moving this one to the next category of things that you could eventually work your way up to buying, but I decided no, this is an essential. This is something you must have in your bag, and that is a prime lens. So this is an 85mm 1.4 lens, or 1.8, I'm sorry, but this also comes in 1.4 and 1.2, getting more and more expensive as you go down the line, but anyways, they're fixed focal length, can't zoom, but they are the most crisp, sharp, colorful lenses you can buy, in my opinion. There's 40mm prime lenses, 50mm, 85mm. These lenses are just really amazing. Beautiful portraits. You will take some of your best portraits of all time with one of these. And also, they're not that expensive, especially if you go for one that's just a 1.8. This thing won't run you that much money at all. Also, with those really fast apertures, you can shoot in low light situations, and also you can get really blurred out, bokehlicious backgrounds, and that's what all of us as photographers want. So this is a lens, this 85mm 1.8. Couldn't recommend this more, but just in general, you need a prime lens in your bag, guys. And finally, the last essential that I think that everyone should have in their bag is a camera cleaning kit. That being said, I can't even find mine right now. I'm putting this on the essentials list. I can't even find mine, but that's just how camera gear works. But anyways, yeah, you need cloths to clean your lenses. You need a sensor cleaning kit, both the little swabs and the blowy things. I don't even know what it's called, guys. Take care of your gear. If you're investing all this money into your gear, you gotta take care of it. And so buy these things. They're really not expensive at all. And just every once in a while, wipe down those lenses, clean off your sensor, your body, everything. Really take care of your gear, guys. I couldn't recommend this more. All right, second, I'm calling this category Essentials 2.0. You've started getting gigs as a photographer. You realize this is really what you want to do. You have this Essentials gear, but you need to step up your game to really get those high-end clients or jobs that you want to get. This is the stuff you need. All right, so this next list of things are things that after you covered the essentials, this is what you work your way up to. I'm still calling it essentials because I think every professional photographer needs these things, but they're not what you need right away. The first thing on this list may be kind of controversial, but I'm putting it there, and that's a second body. You really need a second camera, guys. I think for 90% of the things that photographers shoot, you're gonna need that second body. Whether it's circumstantial, you just need a second body to photograph more things or more versatile things. Say you're at a wedding, you have one camera that has a wide angle lens on it, another camera that has a really zoomed in lens on it. You really need that versatility. But also, it's just for safety. I mean, what happens if you're on a really, really important shoot for a client and your only camera that you brought dies, or you drop it and it breaks, something happens, you're gonna want a second body. So once you're making a little bit more money and you're doing a little more high-end gigs, you're gonna need a second body. It's just, there's no question about it. So my personal second body, it's a Canon 7D Mark II. It's actually what I'm filming on right now. The reason I got my second body is I started shooting a lot of weddings. I just needed a versatile second camera that I could use for any situation. This 7D, it's not a full frame camera. It's actually a crop sensor, but the autofocus is unbelievable and the frame rate is crazy. It takes like 8 photos a second, so you're never missing a shot. If things are moving super fast, you'll always have crisp, sharp images, and it's just an all around amazing camera. When I'm at a wedding, I'll throw my 70 to 200 on that. When I have my wide angle or prime lens on my 5D Mark III, and I'm set. Any situation, far or close, fast or slow, I'm ready for it. The next thing you're really gonna need as a professional is a professional editing suite. Now, yes, I'm talking about Photoshop and Lightroom. They are just the industry standard. They're what everyone is using, and you just need it. Programs like iPhoto, they get the job done, but moving on into your professional career, they're just not gonna cut it. You're really gonna need some high quality professional editing suites like Photoshop and Lightroom. I personally favorite Lightroom. I love all the qualities it has to offer me. It's great at editing mass quantity of photos, editing is amazing, it's super clean, organization is great, but you always need to bring photos into Photoshop, manipulate them, edit them, and Photoshop, you can do anything. It's Photoshop, you guys know. So yes, you're gonna need it eventually. It's really not that expensive anymore. They do it in a way so that you have to buy the Creative Suite, so you pay a monthly fee. It makes it really affordable. You're not paying hundreds of dollars upfront for this program. So the next thing you're probably gonna wanna buy are specialty lenses. What I mean by this are really wide lenses or macro lenses. Really wide lenses can be like 16 millimeters. You can just get everything in the photo. You can even go lower than that and get fisheye looks. That's cool, not my cup of tea, but wide angle lenses, they can give you some really amazing shots. But you also will need them depending on what industry you're in. Landscape photographers, they use wide angle lenses all the time. Real estate photographers, they use them as well to capture all of the room around you. You're really gonna need that stuff. On the other side of things, you're really gonna need a macro lens. The reason I figured out that I needed a macro lens was when I started shooting weddings and I needed to photograph the really intimate, tiny details of the weddings. The rings, the stitching on the dress, you know, the invitations, the cards, all that stuff, you really needed to get in close. And it doesn't matter what other lens you have, nothing's gonna get the job done quite like a macro lens. So you can find some pretty cost-efficient versions of all these lenses. They're not gonna run you too much money, but they're definitely gonna be things that you're gonna need to eventually save up the money for to buy. Guys, this next one, it's really important and I couldn't stress it more, and that's to invest in a good tripod. I don't care what you say, everyone needs a tripod at one point or another in their photography career. Whether it's for landscape photography, self-portraits, portraits in general, whatever, you need a tripod. It's just a good thing to have even if you don't think you're gonna use it, but invest in a good one. I have gone through tons of tripods. I have tried to cheat it just like everyone else and get the really inexpensive ones, and guys, you pay for the quality. If you pay $60 for a tripod, it's not gonna give you good shots, it's gonna fall apart, it's not gonna do a good job. I'll tell you a little story right here. This lens here, this 55-250 that I was telling you about earlier, it's broken. You wanna know why it's broken? I was using it to take a photo on a beach in Florida. You can check out the photo right here. It's not that good of a photo, but I had it up on a tripod. You know, thought it was totally fine. Walked away from my tripod for 1 minute, and guess what? A guy runs by with his dog. The dog takes out a leg of the tripod. The tripod explodes, and that's the end of it. My camera goes into the sand. My lens goes into the sand. Thankfully, I was able to salvage the camera, but this lens, it's toast. It doesn't work. I've tried to get it fixed. It's just not having it. It's not worth it anyways. But anyways, that is a reason why you should invest in a good tripod. Holy shit. Next up, you're gonna need one of these. This is a diffuser / reflector. This thing is amazing. I take it with me on all my shoots, no matter what. Basically what this is, here, I'll show you, hold on. Inside of this thing, you have this little disc with very thin material in it, and it basically diffuses the light. So if it's a really sunny day, you can hold this over the person you're taking photos of and get some really soft, shadowy light instead of the harsh sunlight. So this particular one also comes with this really unique cover on it. It has four sides that you can reverse and everything like that, white, black, gold, and silver. And basically these are used to add light to your subject, subtract light from your subject, give them a nice gold glow, bounce really reflective silver light back into them, fill in one side of their face that's covered in shadows, whatever it might be. This thing I use so much, whether it's for portraits, product photography, anything, you really need something like this. This is another controversial one that may should have gone in the first category, but I'm putting it in this one, and that is speed lights, or any other sort of light for that matter. Guys, you are gonna use these like crazy when you're a photographer. I know they can be super intimidating, lighting artificially. It can be hard, it can be scary. There's so much to it, I totally get that. But once you learn it, these things are a must. They are so versatile, you can use them for anything. the way I use them the most is for weddings, actually. And if you go to a wedding or if you start shooting weddings, you'll see that every wedding photographer does the same thing, and that's taking one, putting it on the top of your camera, and using it in every situation. Because as a wedding photographer, you're gonna be thrown into a ton of different situations and you're gonna need to control your light. That's just how it is. For example, what I do with this is I pop it on the top of my camera, bounce it straight into the ceiling, and every shot I take has a beautiful, diffused, filled light look. And that's just awesome because all my wedding photos come out looking great. Also, if you have the correct rest of the equipment that I'll talk about a little later, you can use this for stuff like portraiture, you can use it for product photography. I use it for all kinds of stuff. Fill in one side of your face that's in shadows for a portrait, completely light a still life set that you're shooting a product for a client. So I know they can be really scary, but save up for one, start using it, start messing around. They're really essential. Something that directly pairs with the speed lights I just talked about are lighting stands and umbrellas. These are stuff you're definitely gonna need if you're ever interested in taking those speed lights I just showed you and using them in any situation other than on top of your camera. And let's be honest, guys, you probably know, as a photographer, putting your flash on the top of your camera, that's not something we do all the time. So just invest in a decent stand or two. This one didn't cost me much money at all. Actually, it was part of a total kit where I got the stand and three umbrellas. It was a really good deal. I'll link it in the description below. But it's just a great quality stand with three different umbrellas, a white one to diffuse light through it. I think a gold one here to give you some warm light, and a silver one, I'll open one of them for you, a silver one to give you a nice bounce. So, ton of versatility. You're gonna need to use light modifiers eventually, guys. I know, just like the speed lights, they can be really scary, but they're a must. Bouncing light through or against an umbrella looks infinitely better than shooting a flash straight at somebody. That's just the basics of photography. And you'll start using these for anything. Like I said, product photography, portraits, you can prop it up anywhere, use these umbrellas, take some really amazing photography. Now, this next one isn't something that you'll see on everyone's list of essentials, but it's definitely on mine, and that is a camera grip. Let me show you how this works. Basically, all this is, it's an extension to the bottom of your camera. So you take your batteries out of the bottom of your camera, you can put two batteries in here, put it, pop this one on here, screw it on, and it becomes the bottom of your camera. Yeah, it makes it really big and really heavy, but I'll tell you why it's worth it. First of all, the one battery that you put in your original camera body, you take two batteries and put it in this grip, making your battery length twice as long, which is awesome, obviously. Second of all, this grip gives you the ability, instead of when you're taking a photo, to flip your hand like that, it gives you the ability to flip your camera and just hold it on the side like this. All the controls are right here on the back, just like on your regular camera, you have all these controls, and it's a really good investment. No, it's not necessary, but it makes your job so much easier, so much less hassle, and it's just a really good investment. I have one on every single one of my bodies. Even this T3i that I got when I was younger, I put one on just because it made everything so much easier. It's so worth it. Guys, if you take one single image for a client and you do not back it up on an external hard drive, you are nuts. Let me make that clear, you're crazy. You're nuts. External hard drives, you have to get them. These are a must. You can't go without them. Every single photo you take as a photographer, back up to one of these. Put one copy on your computer, one copy on this. You need to have your photos in two places. Every experienced photographer can tell you horror stories about times when they did not back up their photos and something happened to wherever they were storing those photos. The files got corrupted, the hard drive crashed, and they lost everything. You do not know true agony until you have to walk up to a client and tell them you have no photos for them. Your whole wedding, your whole photo shoot, whatever, it's gone. Please make sure that never happens to you. buy hard drives, buy a ton of them. They're really not expensive these days, guys. We live in an awesome time when you can buy a terabyte of storage for $100. That's really affordable when you're thinking about the benefit of safely storing all of your amazing images. Personally, I like to use Lacy. I have a ton of these things. I have like a desk drawer filled with 10 of them. These things have never done me wrong. They're super rugged. I actually think they're called rugged Lacys. They look cool. They have this protective barrier on the outside. They're quick and they do the job as they should. Guys, you have to get these. All right, guys, gone are the days of throwing your camera and your lenses just straight into your backpack. You can't do that anymore. If you want to become anything as a photographer, you need something really high quality to carry your gear in, and that is a good quality camera bag. Now, I have a ton of them, and I have different ones for different situations. The one I carry with me everywhere is this one. It's an awesome, super sexy, classy looking messenger bag. I put it through the ringer as well. This thing, it holds a body and three lenses, as well as a laptop. It's super amazing. I love this bag. Awesome way to carry your gear. If I'm gonna be getting a little more rugged, I go to this guy. This is an amazing backpack I got for like $60, super amazing, and it's actually made for photo gear. So I'm not gonna do a whole product review, but a couple cool things that this thing has. It's waterproof, it's never gonna damage your gear. It's got slots and zippers inside for batteries, memory cards, hard drives, all those things. And check this out, this is the coolest part. You open up the zipper back here, and it's a compartment that opens up just for your camera and lenses. It perfectly fits a camera and two lenses. It's exactly what I need when I go hiking, when I go on an airplane and I'm only just going on a vacation. And also, it's got these little hooks down here. You can perfectly fit a tripod in. It's the perfect camera bag for traveling. And then if I'm just doing something really small, I'll take one of these little guys. These are super small, mini, simple bags. You're not gonna carry one of these to one of your high-end shoots, or if you're ever shooting for a client, you're not gonna use one of these guys. But it fits a couple bodies, a couple lenses, you know, minimalistic stuff. This is something I carry with me a lot. If I'm just casually walking around, I wanna carry some camera gear on me. I got it for free too, so that gets the job done. Most importantly, you're gonna want to invest in a roller bag. A really big, high quality roller bag to fit multiple bodies, tons of lenses, all your accessories, anything you might need for your shoot. I don't have mine with me right now, but if you don't get any of these other bags, make sure you get a roller bag because that's really gonna be beneficial for carrying all your equipment. Just like the grips that I showed you guys a second ago, something that isn't crazy essential but'll make your job really easy is versatile camera straps. On my 5D Mark III, I have this good looking one that I use for everyday use. It's just a good looking strap. I love it. It gets the job done. But you really need something more versatile for high end, high pressure shoots for clients and stuff like that. A brand that I could not recommend more is Black Rapid. They make some freaking high quality straps for any situation you guys might need. So these straps that I'm about to talk about, I'll link them down in the description and probably throw them up here on the screen. The first one I ever shot was when I was shooting a lot of sports at the university I went to, and I just needed a strap that if I was running down the court or down the field or something, it would stay on my shoulder. So I got this really inexpensive but super versatile strap that went over my shoulder and under my armpit and over my arm so that it just stayed there on your shoulder and it was not going anywhere. Now that strap was awesome and it definitely got the job done, but once I started doing weddings, I realized I definitely needed something a little better than that. So I got this bad boy. Yeah, this thing lets you like double wield like crazy Western pistol style. This thing is amazing. You throw it over your shoulders, clip it all up, you look crazy, you look like you're about ready to go to war or something like that, but you can hold two camera bodies on your side ready to pop up, take photos whenever the moment happens. Guys, the strap is freaking unbelievable. A lot of photographers I know, they say it's just way too much. They don't like how it looks or feels. Guys, you're a photographer. This is not a fashion contest. Wear the thing that gets the job done. I don't care how I look in this thing. Yeah, I probably look ridiculous, but I get the shot every time because my cameras are ready to go. All right, so the final thing I'm gonna throw in the Essentials 2.0 category is business cards. Guys, if you ever are planning on growing your business, getting your name out there, making sure people know you, know your information, know how to contact you, get these. And if I hear one of you complaining about the price of these, I'm gonna personally come over there and slap you, because it costs next to nothing to print good quality business cards. Mine right here, I love. They're really thick, durable, glossy paper, double-sided, full color, fully customizable. Guys, I got these printed, 250 of them for $6. Yes, 250 for $6. Anyone could buy these. I don't care who you are. This can be the first thing you ever buy because you can afford it. There's no reason in the world why you shouldn't be purchasing these and handing them out to every single person you run into. All right, guys, finally we made it to the category, luxuries. Now, everything in this category is by no means essential, hence the title, but these type of things are just for professionals, people who are making a lot of money, getting a lot of clients. They really need that specialty gear to make their work, to take their work to the next level. So let's find out what they are. First thing up on the list of luxuries is crazy long lenses. I'm talking about 300, 400, 600, even 800 millimeter lenses. Now, obviously, I do not have any of those to show to you guys because I'm not willing to drop $6,000 to $12,000 on a lens. But anyways, these lenses are for very, very specific purposes. If you're getting a lens that big, you're shooting wildlife, high-end sports, or you're just like a peeping Tom who's really curious about your next door neighbor. But really, there's no reason for the average person to ever invest in that type of gear. Another thing that definitely isn't necessary, but I definitely recommend, would be a shutter release. Now, these come in handy in certain circumstances. I've used this thing a few times, but if you ever have your camera up on a tripod or something, or you're not near your camera, and you need to take the photo from away, that's what this is for. It also can provide a way for you to take photos without bumping your camera at all. For example, if you're doing long exposure photography and you don't wanna bump your camera as you take the photo with your finger, you can just press this button. This is a cheap, crappy one, doesn't work very well. You can get nicer ones. But honestly, I don't use this too much. I find it, if I don't want to bump the trigger, I'll just set my camera on a 2-second timer, press the button, wait a couple seconds, then take the photo. It comes in handy every once in a while, but you definitely don't need it. Probably one of the more important things on this list of luxuries is going to be remote triggers. Triggers to trigger all your flashes and strobes and speed lights. Like I said before, if you're ever wanting to get into strobe photography off your camera, you know, taking your strobe off the top of your camera and putting it on a stand or something like that, you're gonna need some of these guys. Basically, all this is, you put one of them on top of your camera, you put the other one on your flash. Every time you take a photo, it fires your flash. There's no way for your flash to fire otherwise. So no, you don't need them. Not everyone uses flash photography if that's not their thing, but if you do, you're gonna need these. One of the most useful luxuries on this list is gonna be filters. Now, there are a ton of different types of filters. I could make a video by itself of just filters, but I'm just gonna give you a little bit of an explanation for why you want these. The most important filters, in my opinion, are the filters you just put on the end of your lens to protect them. You won't be able to see it, but on my 85 here, I have one. It's just a clear filter that you put on the end of your lens. If you ever drop your lens or anything like that, it's gonna break the filter and not your lens. It's just a good way to protect it. Like I said before, you're investing a lot of money into your glass, into your camera. Protect it, just buy a filter. But there's tons of different types of filters out there. Filters that affect your exposure and your gradients on your shots and all sorts of stuff. Again, that's a whole video by itself, so I won't talk too much about it, but look into it. They're super, super helpful. Not necessary, like I'm saying, but definitely, definitely useful. Now is time for my personal favorite item on this list of luxuries. Hold on, 1 second. Oh, Jesus. Printers. This is a Canon PIXMA Pro printer. This is my other baby. I love this thing
to death.
I got a really good deal on it when I made another purchase a couple years ago, but this thing is amazing. Being able to print your own professional quality photo prints straight from home, it's like, that's a dream come true. I'm so thankful for it. Saves you a lot of money as well. But anyways, a printer is 100% something I would recommend you buy at some point in your photography career. Definitely not the first thing you're gonna buy. There's no point in buying a printer right off the bat. There are so many cheap, cost-effective ways to buy prints online or at any of your Walmarts or local photography stores near you. So save that money you would spend on a printer for the stuff I mentioned at the beginning of the video. But when the time is right, or you get an offer that's really appealing, or you have the money, or you've bought everything else, or whatever it might be, this is something you should definitely buy. Can't recommend it more. It's so great being able to print your own stuff. I can print anything from a tiny little wallet size print all the way up to 20 inches. I can even print on CDs and thumb drives on this. Like, it's amazing. I love it. I'll eventually upgrade to a higher professional quality printer that can do bigger stuff, but this thing is amazing. I recommend it so much. All right, yes, I did purposefully save the most fun one for last. That's drones. Everyone's talking about drones these days. I don't blame them. They're freaking awesome. They're amazing. They completely have changed the world of photography and videography. Being able to go up in the sky, get those shots, get those angles, it's absolutely amazing. It's just something we as photographers have never really had the ability to do for so cheap, you know? Before, you would have to fly up in a helicopter or an airplane to get those types of shots. Now you can drop a few hundred or $1,000 on a drone. There you go. But it's on my list of luxuries because that's exactly what it is, a luxury. There's no real reason to have a drone for client work unless it's a real niche. I'm not gonna say there's no reason, there are tons of reasons, but as the average photographer, you're not gonna use it much. Some clients might ask for it, you might use it for a wedding or two, but other than that, it's just really cool. It's just freaking awesome. I'll admit it, I'm gonna get one day. I don't have one right now. I have one in my Amazon cart. It's just a cool thing to buy. I get it, but you don't need it. Don't go get it right off the bat. First thing as a photographer, you don't need it, guys. Wait, save up for some good lenses and cameras, then go buy the cool drone. So guys, I think that's it. I think that's all you need to know to go start collecting your own arsenal of photography gear. I told you what you need to buy right off the bat, what's essential, what you need right away. You know, what can wait, but you'll need one day. And I told you about the luxuries that you'll never really need, but they can make things easier or just plain fun. Hopefully I helped you out a little bit. Hopefully you learned something that you didn't know before watching this video. Yeah, I probably missed a thing or two here or there, depending on, you know, what kind of stuff you like, what kind of stuff you use to take your photography. So if there's something I forgot, something that you guys can't live without, go ahead and leave it in the comments. I'd love to hear what you guys use. Anyways, I'm done talking. I've been talking for a super long time. I'm sorry this was such a long video. And most importantly, don't forget to smash that like button below. Subscribe if you want to. That would be super awesome. That would show me your support for creating more content like this. I really want to. I'm really excited for it. So that would be greatly appreciated. Thanks for watching, guys. Hope you tune in next time. Have a good one.